shadow, lost and lonely. No one can blame you for walking away. But too much rejection, no love injection, Life can't be easy. It's not always well. Don't tell me truth hurts, little girl, 'cause it hurts like hell. But down in the underground, you'll find someone true. Down in the underground, a land serene, a crystal.
The animation, it has to, animation, here's a ball, and then it goes here, and then it goes here. It really has to look like a cartoon.
So then, these, the animator.
Yeah. And so we have it like that, and then like that, and like that, and like that.
Right.
This has to look like a very slight change, so it really looks like it's moving and everything. And the group, the animators in group A, they make that go down. Because they have to make that go up.
And did the people in the, in each group decide?
They decided what they wanted.
What they wanted it to. Okay.
So I was not forced to do script writing. Because I really wanted to do sound, but somebody got sound. So
oh, they
I'm
got
doing
sound
script
first.
Writing.
I see. Okay.
So, because buttons are really a pain. Because it opens up, and then you don't know where you are. Automatic. A browser that doesn't know anything, doesn't know where you are. If he opens browser and saw Mac,
right.
So you can't and make buttons. You have to really, but so it's really to it.
Okay, I'm planning on this.
A lot of planning.
How much time do you think you spend talking about it and thinking about it as well as to learn on HyperCard?
We mostly do it on HyperCard and experimenting. Now we don't really get into it yet, but what really got them thinking about it is the button that I brought. Because now they know lots of possibilities for it to open. See right here, it's iris open.
Uh-huh.
Now they know for them, they could also do barn doors and everything.
Right. Now, is that the first time you've worked with buttons in your for this?
For class, yes. For me, no.
Yeah.
Computers are stupid. They don't know what. And whoever you see next is going to say they need a better scripting language because it's not very good scripting language. It has some very good scripting sounds and things, but it's hard to work with.
It's hard because it doesn't
have all the words that we know. It has words that are weird. It has some like weird words.
Okay.
And it has... and as if else, if and then else. That's not what we usually say. Record, like when you do scripting, it might be a good idea to also add to the objects when you record a sound.
Okay, so you can put your own sounds in there. Yeah. You can put your own voice in.
And it'll be much easier.
Okay, is that it, Josh?
I think that's it.
All right, thank you.
There's this clown and she was happy and it said Miss Clown and she wanted to go out of the circus and have some fun. She went out to this park and she goes out and she's gonna take off her hat and she's taking off her hat. And she's when she all of it, she's gonna be so happy and she's gonna be like playing around.
Okay.
I made a field and I made a button and I put it inside the coral. So I click on it and it tells you a fact about coral. And how I did it is I go here and I'll make one for, maybe I'll make one for the lobster. I'll go to the field and I go new field. And here's my field. And so I click on it twice and then it's gonna be called Shrimp's Field. And then I go to shadow. You want it to be a shadow. You don't lock the text or you won't be able to write. You go to your scripts and you write on mouse up. And then we write hide card field, and we have to go to the number, we have to press OK, you click on it again, and it says card field number 4, so you go to the scripts, and you space, do return, and mouse up, and you go to OK. Now,
we didn't make that. That's printed from somebody else. And
who's we?
Well, me and my friend Zev.
Okay, so you kind of did this together?
Yeah. Zev got lots of the art, and I did a lot of the programming because I'm not too great with drawing. There are a few buttons that give you points. And we didn't want people to keep just pressing this button and they keep getting points. Uh-huh. So what it does is, each time you get some points from this button, it puts into this field. This field will go in every card. And it looks back at the field, and if the field has number one, if the field has one in it, it'll say, hey, you've already pressed this button, you know. Now it's saying add word one of back, add one to word one of background field. So that this is just checking what if he's done anything. Set lock screen to true is just making it so it doesn't flip between cards. Then it says click a lock of background button one, which is up here, which goes to that card.
Right.
And it says put word one of line 3 of card field card into points. So that's putting what points you have right now into points. How many points? Set lock text of card field 2 to false. That's just so you can put in the number of points. So then it's add 9 to points. So it's adding 9 to the variable points. Then it's saying put points into word 1 of line 3 of card field 2, which is putting the points into the field. Because help's real confusing if you don't already know how. So, I looked in help about variables.
Uh-huh.
I've used like basic before, so
you already
know
had
about
the idea of a variable.
Yeah. There are lots of games, but most of them are just cards and there's buttons. Like most games, it just has like fight and you fight him and then it says like what weapon do you want and you like click on the button and it's just clicking buttons linking to other cards.
Okay.
But this is more like if you say fight him, it looks in your inventory to see if you have the right weapon, or if you say magic, it looks in inventory to see if you have the right like spell or potion.
And if you don't, what happens? It gives you
you die.
Oh.
Because,
be careful then.
Yeah. In HyperCard, I think you can do anything. It's just a matter of knowing how to do it. Because I've never found, I've found stuff like, how do you do this? And then I look and help rest Mr. Mintz, and he knows how, but I've never run into something.
So you haven't run into anything that you really couldn't do that you wanted to do with it.
Right.
Okay. Did you plan this ahead of time, or did you kind of?
No, I just went, I did it as I went. I didn't plan it.
And then, let me see now, you have buttons in there, right?
Yeah.
Have you done any scripts? Do you know what the scripts are?
Mm-hmm.
Can you show me a script for them?
Well, like this.
How did you learn what the script was to make that visual effect?
Well, I had lessons on it, and some people helped me on it because I didn't have any idea what this was about. I do pictures and stuff.
So you do these pictures yourself?
Yeah, but the other ones I scanned on the scanner. And I started to put some information here. This is where leopards come from.
The information?
From books.
And you get to say whatever you want about it? You don't. Are there certain things you're supposed to say about the leopard? Or?
Yeah, like how long it lives and what it eats.
Where did you get that picture? Is that scanned?
I scanned it from a book.
Do you think it works better than when you write? You used to write reports, right?
Yeah, I don't write anything on paper now. I write it all on the computer.
Okay, so you do it either in a word processor, like you use MacWrite, right?
Yeah.
I see. Okay. So everything you do for school now, you do on the computer.
Yeah, most of it.
Do you have a computer at home?
No.
So you learn to do everything at school then, right?
Yeah.
Yours is the first one I've seen with a menu. Is that your idea to put the menu at the beginning?
Yeah. Well, actually, I get kind of ideas from other things that I see. So it's like, you need to go back to the main menu in case you want to make a different decision. Uh-huh. That's not really my favorite things to do with HyperCard. I like making things like little adventures or things like that. So here's one little thing I made at the beginning of the year. Because we had to make a creative writing assignment to make a stack on supposedly the Fleming Mansion. It's an old place and it's a haunted house and it's really spooky and what happens, like that. So I made a HyperCard stack. Mystery of the Fleming Mansion, blah, blah, blah. And it tells it to come in, to take the door. And it asks you if you want to knock, so you click that.
Look a little louder, because it's...
And then tells you to come in, so you click the door. And then we had to put words into it, like words that they told you to do, so a shadow would go on. So you go on. I love these little effects. I don't know. I made another version, but
let's
it's
see
changed.
This. Why don't you show the script for that and show how you decided to do that?
Oh. It's a button script, my mistake. I just thought up the notes and wrote them down.
Oh, wait a minute. How did you know that that was going to make the tune for...
Well, I don't know. I play piano, so I have kind of like
so
musical a, ear to know what
so
note it's going to play.
You had a good guess about what the notes
yeah.
were going to be. Did you have to correct any of it when you...
Well, yeah, I play it through what I've got, and then if I find there's some mistakes, I go back and change it or add or whatever I want to it.
But you didn't have to play it on the piano first. You just
no,
you knew
I just knew
what
it.
The notes were.
Like I made. Like Bach. So then you press start. And it's like you control the little guy moving. Like A is to jump, so you press A. Boom, sound effects. Yeah, this kind of shows how music can interact with things you want.
So there's kind of a story to it, isn't there?
Yeah.
Now, did you plan that ahead of time, or did you just kind of...
Well, before I make a stack, I always think of what I'm going to do before I just go in there and waste extra memory. Or, like, sometimes it's just, like, doodling around when I'm kind of bored. There's this one little stack where, like, I was kind of bored, so I just decided to do something. I don't know. This was another experiment with dragging. I trashed this one. A little shoot the basket. That's it. Here's where the decision making comes in. That's pretty popular in our class, decision making with buttons. So like you could either block, you can either duck, or you can punch.
Now, you said something about that's real popular in class, decision making. What do you mean?
Well,
why are you calling it decision making?
Because you have a choice to make. You can either make this as a decision, this or this. And that's probably one of the most popular things kids use on their HyperCard stacks. Because it's like you finally get to interact with HyperCard. That's really popular. And people like to do that.
But where did you get those words, decision making? Where did you think of that? Teacher said, or is that
no?
That
I just
came up from the kids.
I just know that.
Okay.
See, it's like somebody learns something and then it flows around, and so then everybody does it. It's like that.
Do you think that happens more? Do you think that happens more from using HyperCard and using the computers than it did when you were? Do you remember when you weren't using computers?
Yeah, when we weren't using computers, no, because like what was there to do? Maybe drawing or different ideas in drawing. People didn't really anything really good. So when we first got HyperCard and we learned something new, people wanted to know that and everybody else.
Now let's see each card.
That's eight.
That's your title card, right?
One.
How do you make
this? Is one. This is two. I drew it. This is three, four, five.
With the six times seven?
X.
How did you know how to make it black like that? Wasn't that? Show us how you did that.
I made it with that.
Oh, I see. And did you do that at the very beginning, or did you do it after you started it?
I did it after I drew that, and then I made a white line, so it wouldn't just blend into the black. I made a white line behind.
It's the man.
Now, what makes that move? How do you know? How can you make that go hard?
I forgot.
Where's the button? Try it.
Okay, Lauren, have you made buttons on there?
Yeah, there
it is. Do you know how to find them?
No.
When you go to make a button, how do you do it?
You go into tools, you press the button.
Okay. See where the buttons are.
Oops.
Okay, that's for the button.
See the doctor. Hey.
No.
And now she has 19 babies.
And
he said, I have my hair. And then she goes flying up in the air because it's soap. That's it.
Okay, now when you made that story, did you have the story first, or did you make the drawings and then think up the story?
I was just thinking of things the right. It wasn't really.
So you kind of did you put the writing in there? After
think of a picture.
So you're thinking of a story for the.
I'm Mike Travers from the MIT Media Lab and the Vivarium Project. This is up here in my road called AGAR. That's an animal construction kit. The animals that are running now are ants. And what they do is they go and find food, and they engage in cooperative behavior in order to bring this food back to their nest. This line here is the remains of a food trail from a pile of food that they've used up. We leave another pile of food for them here. You'll see that eventually an ant will notice it and go back to the nest, leaving a trail. Now the other ants then will use the trail to find the rest of the food, and you can see that there's some ants following the trail right there. As they continue to bring food back, the trail gets reinforced. If the trail doesn't get reinforced, it will evaporate, which is happening up there. But since while the food is there, the trail builds up exponentially, and the ants can get a great deal of ant power to the food in a short period of time. We can look at how the ants follow the trail if we stop them for a minute, and we make some of their sensors visible. They have two sensors for trail following, right and left hand one, and now we see them. Now the ant's going to carry sensors when he hits the trail, when and if. You'll see that he tries to keep the sensors on either side of the trail, and if only one of them is, he'll turn to correct that, and so he follows this sort of S-shaped curve. Now we can also see what the rules by which he uses the sensors. The behavioral system of the ant is organized as a network of agents. An agent is responsible for one particular aspect of behavior, and it consists of a set of rules. If we take a single step over here, we can see the agents that are active for the particular ant that's selected, which is this one here with the asterisk on it. The names and light type are the agents that are active. The bold face type is the actions that actually get executed. So you see a lot of agents are on, but only some of them are actually generating movements. In fact, only basic movement, which is just telling the ant to go forward. And if we keep stepping, we'll see that that's mostly what happens, except now the basic movement agent looks at the wall sensor. This time it went off. The ant sees that it can set a wall, and it sends out two action commands. One, this is actually to turn off the forward motor, and then to do a 180 degree turn, more or less. And the ant does that when we let the mouse button go. And so that's the general scheme of things. If we get the ant to the trail, let's see how that works. It's just doing his default things now. Now the food recruit sensors went off. That triggered some extra agents, which also triggered some actions. He's turning in the appropriate direction. And now he's turning in the other direction, and he'll continue this until he follows the trail to the nest, which is not the direction that they want to go to. Right now they don't have any way to distinguish between one direction on the trail and the next. Now remember, the idea of the trail is that an ant who finds food leaves a trail back to the nest that other ants can use to find the food. There's no way for them to make sure they're following the trail in the right direction, but we're working on it.
How do they know which direction to go?
They don't.
In real life, they don't?
In real life, it's more complicated. Well, actually, a better question for this simulation is, how do they know how to get back to the nest in the first place? How do they know what direction it's in? And in fact, right now, they're mostly cheating. They get that information from an oracle. In real life, ants use a number of different ways of telling direction, including looking at the sun, seeing what direction the light is coming from, following old trails, and memory based on landmarks. Right now, we're not simulating any of those. We cheat, but we acknowledge that we're cheating, so it's okay. They make a small effort to distinguish what direction the trail is going by comparing differential concentrations. Since the The trail is left from the food to the nest, and it evaporates over time. There's going to be a stronger concentration nearer the nest, so the ant wants to go in the direction of the weaker concentration, and they try and do that, given the limits of the simulation, that it doesn't always succeed.
Okay, that's really good. How about fish?
Fish. I wonder if we could show the Lisp code for an agent down there.
Sure. Where's it going to show up down?
Down there.
Okay.
We can look at how an agent is specified. The edit agent. This is a list of all the agents that make up an app right now. And we'll look at the, we'll look at the home in on food agent. The definition of that agent, definition of that agent is down here. It's down here. So what the agent does when it's activated, and it has to be activated by another agent, it turns off some other agents, such as the direction randomizer agent and the follow recruitment trail. Okay, I should explain. What this agent does, when an ant is right in front of a food, he has two other sensors that let him approach the food, get right on top of it, and pick it up. That's what this agent is for. And it uses a couple of other sensors, which we'll highlight here. Oops. Oh, I know what's going to happen. We might want to retake this. Take a look at what the homing food homing sensors look like.
Okay, wait a minute. Let me just get this guy. Okay.
What we've got here, we'll let the ant get to the end of the trail so we can see what's going on a little better. Oops, two ants in a collision there. Okay. Now our selected ant is showing his left food homing sensor. Let's get that view. He's got two sensors, which are function more or less like eyes, a left and a right one, and they're sensitive to food within the area of this sort of circular segment. So what happens if a food segment is found in that region, the ant will turn to the left. If it's found on the other side, he'll turn to the right, and he'll move slowly toward it, wiggling back and forth, and then when he's right on top of it, he'll pick it up. So we'll turn off the drawing of that right now. And we'll look at the agent that uses those again, home in on food. So what home in on food does, which is in charge of using those sensors, it turns off the direction randomizer, turns off the trail recruitment following mechanism, because if he sees the food in there, he knows that's a better way of picking up food than following the trail. This says to go forward slowly, six units, which is about half the normal speed. And then this looks at the sensors. When the left food homing sensor is on, turn to the left, minus 10. If the right food homing sensor is on, turn to the right, 10. If they're both on, which is unlikely because their ranges don't overlap much, those numbers will just be summed and there'll be no turn. Another agent, pick up food, uses another sensor that lets the ant know if he's right on top of the food of a piece of food, and that says that okay, when that sensor goes on, when we're right on top of a piece of food, and we're not at the nest because we don't want to pick up food that's already in the nest, and we're not already holding something, then don't go forward. This is a command to the forward motor to go 0 units. And tell the hold motor to grab, and then do an immediate about face, so we're facing in the opposite direction from where we came, which is a good approximation to getting back to the nest. So there's about 12 or so agents, all of them are about that size, and they're combined in a network that produces this intelligent behavior out of a very few simple actions, which are to go forward, to turn, and to pick things up and let them go. I estimate that maybe 100 agents or a few hundred agents are needed to simulate a real ant, which does many more things than just get food. They do defense, they communicate with each other, they build their nest, and they reproduce. This is a good first step.
Now, most social insects don't remember for a long period of time. As I recall, bees tend not to remember much beyond 24 hours or something like that. And that must help if you only have 100,000 neurons.
Yeah, these ants don't remember anything at all right now, except they have a very limited form of memory in terms of a hysteresis on their agents, meaning that an agent, once it's triggered, can keep acting after the initial stimulus has been removed, and that lets them do things. Meaning, if they're after a piece of food and suddenly go past it, they'll know that they still need to go looking for that piece of food rather than just keep on blithely going by. As far as long-term memory of spatial memory of routes and things, there's none of that in the simulation unless you want to count the smell that's left on the ground as a form of memory. But you can consider systems that will build new agents or modify existing agents in order to produce changes in behavior that are beneficial. For instance, learning to recognize an enemy is a popular form of learning, and that can be done by adding conditions to the escape agent, sensory conditions.
Great. Terrific.
Great.
You're quite amazing the way you're...
It's winding something up.